What's going on, guys? This is Rob. If you guys enjoy my content, make sure you hit the subscribe button and make sure you hit that little bell so you never miss out on my sexy voice. Okay, guys, we're continuing with Ultimatum, and in this story, everybody dies, basically. I mean, I'm not laughing because everybody dies. I'm laughing because I just thought up an awesome idea for a video. This is sad. So, like, for those of you guys who are picking up with this, basically, Magneto attacked the world, right? Like, he used the hammer of Thor and was just like, okay, so, like, the world's screwed. Frodo froze over Latveria and launched, like, a massive flood against New York. And this was just a way for Marvel to kind of, like, stem the flow of things. But all this was done because Magneto's just pissed, right? Like, he's really mad because Quicksilver and Scarlet Witch died. Like, his kids are basically dead. All right, it's understandable. It makes sense to me. So the cool thing about this is what's really kind of crazy. People will say that Ultimatum goes off the rails, right? Like, they'll say the story started out pretty awesome and then it just went absolutely insane. I never really saw it that way. It's a comic book story. So it's about as bonkers as any comic book story can get, but it's also written by Jeff Lowe, of course, him being an exceedingly overrated writer. But still, we end up finding out that, like, Scarlet Witch is basically talking to Magneto. And that's kind of the crazy thing, because on the outset, it's like, well, maybe he's hallucinating. Now, ultimately, this turns out to be Mystique, but it's one of those funny things where it's like kind of playing mind games with Magneto to a degree. And you usually see that with the character of Mystique, right? Like, that's what she's most known for. At the same time all this has been happening, in places like Europe, there have been like all these suicide bombers going on. Well, come to find out, what Magneto's been doing is he's been holding Jimmy Madrox, the Multiple Man. He's been basically been keeping him in hiding and forcing him to make duplicates of himself. And those duplicates are basically being laced with explosives and sent into public places and then blowing everything up. It's literally Magneto's war on the world. But it is kind of crazy here, because at this point, we switch over to the Blob, right? And this is one of those instances where people say the story went off the rails, right? Like, the Blob had basically eaten Janet Van Dyne. I don't understand what it is with the Ultimate Universe and folks eating folks. I don't understand that. Like, the Incredible Hulk eats people, the Blob is eating people. Everybody's eating everybody else in the Ultimate Universe, man. They just run around eating folks. Like, it's crazy. It's weird. It's a little bit funny because, like, I remember reading this when it came out, and like, you turn a page and the Blob is just like munching. He's like, nom, 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 just like munching on Janet Van Dyne. And it's like, man, you can't run around eating folks, man. Like, that's not okay, man. You can't run around like eating people. But like, in response to this, Hank Pym just kind of snaps and bites off the head of the Blob. Now, again, this is a throwback to really the main Marvel universe and Hank Pym's character kind of pushed to the extreme. And the reason why I say that is Hank Pym has been like every 15-year-old kid ever. You have no idea who you are, where you're going, or what you're going to do with yourself. You're trying to understand your place in the bigger picture. You're graduating out into the greater tribe of society. Hank Pym was like that, except he'd been that way for like 20 years, right? Like, he'd never grown out of being 15. And so the result was that he had all these different personalities, and he would go through these crises. He would backhand his wife like Reed Richards had done like a zillion times before. He's always been one of these characters where it's been like one part mentally unstable, one part trying to figure himself out with a dash of crazy. And so because of that, like with his character being like that, that's exactly how it is here. For him, like, he grabs Hank Pym and he's like, everything's gonna be, I'm sorry, he grabs Janet and he's like, everything's gonna be okay. And Hawkeye's just kind of like, I mean, no, dude, like, it's not gonna be okay. Her guts are hanging out. She's dead, man. Like, it's time for you to let go of Janet Van Dyne. Like, she's dead. She was eaten by a great big fat guy. She's gone, man. And it's one of those things where it's like Hank Pym keeps talking to her. Again, the huge aftermath of this, really the big takeaway from all these things is that a massive number of the X-Men have died. Like, a massive number of the X-Men are basically out of commission here. You've got Beast who's dead, you've got Nightcrawler who's dead. You have like a huge, like there are a ton of these guys. It's like, man, like it's decimation on a massive scale. And that's kind of the funny thing, is because Warren Worthington kind of jumps up and is like, all my friends are dead, I'm gonna go fight Magneto. Now, a lot of people will say that's kind of out of character for Warren Worthington. Not at all. In fact, he's always been a bit of a hothead, even in the main Marvel universe. So like, him being written this way here actually kind of makes sense. The problem with this is that Warren Worthington's an idiot. Like, if he believes he's gonna travel to the Citadel of Magneto, who's wielding Thor's hammer, a dude with wings, and he's like, I've got angel's wings. I'm just going to pummel you. That's ridiculous. Like, it's nonsense. It's like an ant getting pissed off that you stepped on its friend. But still, like you know, you have like Jean Grey, who kind of speaks up and says, look, like, Charles Xavier's dead. It's really one of these things where like the X-Men are in shambles. And that's why this works so well, is because you never really see anything like this. You've had events take place in the main Marvel universe where the X-Men have kind of been pushed to a point where the team doesn't know if they're going to recover. The first death of Jean Grey, the second and third and fourth and fifth deaths of Jean Grey. You've had Charles Xavier, who's died on a multitude of occasions. You know, you had Cyclops, who abandoned the team. Storm took up, you know, as leadership role in his place. Eventually, Cyclops came back after X-Factor was rolled over back into Uncanny X-Men, and then you had X-Men Gold and X-Men Blue. You've had all these circumstances where, like, the X-Men have been pushed to the extreme, but they always snap back. They always recover. Even Decimation and House of M, when 98% of the mutant population lost their powers, they all consolidated. Like, what was left of them, or at least the ones they knew about, the 198, all consolidated at the Xavier Institute. So it was picking up the pieces and moving forward. With this, it's basically shattered. But it's kind of cool because then you have people speaking up and basically saying, look, we could fly in. Like we could go in and we could face off against Magneto, but we're almost guaranteed to die if we do that. If we're going to defeat the man who basically destroyed the world, then like we need all of us as the X-Men, whatever, you know, whoever we can gather. We need the Fantastic Four. We need the Ultimates, which are the Ultimate Universe Avengers. We need all these people banded together, like brought together for the purpose of trying to defeat Magneto. And that's kind of the funny thing is because when you're talking about Magneto, and this is one of the reasons why I loved Ultimatum so much, is it puts him on full display, right? Like, as far as I'm aware in Marvel Comics, Magneto has never been confirmed to be an Omega level mutant, meaning he's a legitimate planetary threat. But when it comes to Marvel Comics in truth, he really is. I mean, you're talking about a guy who can control the electromagnetic spectrum. I mean, he did that here in this story. He switched the magnetic poles and sent the planet into disarray. And so when you're talking about like that level of power, the ability to control pretty much the entire electromagnetic spectrum, if Magneto chose to, he could just crush the world. And that's why this is so cool, because this gives us that. Magneto is an absolute demon. I mean, like the kind of things he can pull off are insane. And so that's why it's so interesting, is because you're talking about a legitimate guy who could cause like a planetary catastrophe. And for whatever reason, it was just never really written that way. So at this point, we switch over to Captain America and Thor, right? I mean, we're talking about the idea that Valkyrie, who was a love interest of Thor in the Ultimate Universe, had basically been killed. And the idea was that Thor himself and Captain America had taken off to basically go to the realm of the dead in order to get the essence, or in order to get the spirit of Valkyrie back. Now, Captain America's here because he is legitimately dead. He died in the attack on New York. And so the result is that Thor chose to come here in order to be able to pull it off. And that's one of the things to keep in mind. When you're talking about comic books and you're talking about these ethereal realms, the astral plane, the realm of the dead, different things like that, they can be accessed if you know how. Captain America couldn't really get there unless he had died, unless he had organically traveled there. For example, the realm of Mephisto, Captain America wouldn't be able to get there unless he bartered with Mephisto and then Mephisto stole a soul so that when he dies, he ends up in Mephisto's realm. With Hela, it's the exact same thing. He ends up in quote unquote the realm of the dead. That's kind of how this whole thing unfolds. And so because of this, it's interesting here because they've basically been fighting the army of the dead, fighting the army of Hela in order to get back the soul of Valkyrie. Well, that's one thing to bear in mind here. Hela is much like Mephisto, where Mephisto says, hey, look, like if you do what I ask you to do, if you pledge your soul to me or something like that, Mephisto will say, I will give you eternal life. What he won't tell you is that you'll live for eternity with like a miserable life, basically. Like there's always a caveat. There's always a catch. With Hela, it's much like that. Her whole idea is, you've defeated my army of the dead, so I will give you back Valkyrie. But she gives him back the dead body of Valkyrie. And the whole thing is, you know, look, I didn't say she would be alive. I just said you would get her body back. And that's one of the things that goes on with Hela, because for someone to leave, someone has to stay. There has to be equal in for equal out. And so with this whole situation, the idea is, I will give you her essence back. I will give you her spirit. I will return her to life. But in order to do that, you have to sacrifice your life. And Captain America kind of steps up and says, I'll be the one to do it. And it kind of makes sense, right? Like when it comes to Captain America, no matter what comic era you're reading, it's always the same thing. He'll do whatever he believes to be the right thing. It's always the honorable thing. That's one of the reasons why Captain America is such a timeless character. And so it's really kind of a debate that goes back and forth between Captain America and Thor. Is Thor going to be the one to sacrifice his life? And Thor's just kind of like, look, no, I should be the one to do this. But Captain America makes a really good point here. He says, look, man, you came here to rescue the soul of Valkyrie. Are you really just going to sacrifice your life so she can leave? What was the point of coming here in the first place? So it's interesting, like, to see how these arguments and these discussions take place between these guys. And so what we end up doing is basically picking up with the Triskelion. Now remember, the Triskelion is the base of operations for what's basically S.H.I.E.L.D. and the Ultimates themselves. And this whole situation here is that you basically have these Jamie Madrox multiple men who are just kind of launching the siege on the Triskelion. Now, of course, the Ultimates, S.H.I.E.L.D., they're all responding as you would expect. But in the midst of all this, Hank Pym does the only thing that he believes to be the right thing to do. Now, he's still saying, like, you know, take care of Janet, things like that. It's a guy who can't get past the fact that his wife is dead. But while everyone's saying, like, dude, your wife is dead, man, just be a superhero and just do what you have to do. It sucks. Grieve later like everybody else is doing. Hank Pym actually draws the attention of all the multiple men, and they start basically descending onto him. They all detonate their bombs at the same time, and Hank Pym explodes and dies. And so it's interesting. I mean, he kind of goes out like a hero, a crazy hero, but it does work out. Because from there, you basically pick up with Valkyrie returning to life, and then you pick up with Steve Rogers bouncing back, basically telling us Thor sacrifices life in order to bring back Captain America, in order to bring back Valkyrie. Now, this also, I think, is probably the best decision Thor could have made. And the reason why is because when it comes to the various iterations of the Avengers team, Thor's muscle. Thor's not a rallying point. Captain America is the rallying point. He's the rallying point for everybody to kind of pick up. And so with Captain America being who he is, it makes the most sense to bring him in. And so with Steve Rogers coming back, he basically says, we have to gather everyone. Magneto launched this attack on the world. We have to launch an attack to Magneto. So I want every single superhero that exists across the world, every X-Man, every mutant, all the Fantastic Four. I want every single person with a superpower, every single person, whether they're hero or they're villain. I want them all gathered up. I want them all banded together, because at this point, we're not fighting bad guys. We're fighting for the future of the world. And so it's basically going to turn into the entire Marvel Universe versus Magneto. But with that being said, guys, we're going to bring this video to an end. If you are new here to Comics Explained, make sure you guys hit the sub button to become part of the Rob Corps. If you guys enjoyed this video, make sure you drop a like. And yeah, I will catch you all later. Peace.